Good afternoon, and welcome to my discussion board for History 701, Week 5. For this discussion board thread, I chose to change course a little and actually look more at prisoners of war during the Civil War instead of focusing specifically on the Labor Code. Though a search through the America History and Life database did actually yield results for the Labor Code, for myself, I felt that this week I needed to remind myself, why was I looking at the Labor Code in the first place? And so because of that, I turned my research to prisoners of war and their experiences. When conducting the research required for this assignment, a plethora of materials eventually revealed itself. However, I have chosen only three to examine this week. The first is by Rusty Neal, Professor Emeritus at Morrison University, entitled We Were Surrendered, Civil War Prisoners and the Trauma of Capture. Now, Dr. Neal is examining the emotional, physical, and mental trauma experienced by the men who were surrendered to the enemy. He starts by looking at the first few hours of capture as remembered or detailed by former prisoners of war. Then he shifts to consider the actions of the captors towards those men. And then he finally concludes by looking at the prisoners' impressions of those men. The second essay I chose to examine is by Dr. Gregory J.W. Yerwin. He's a professor at Temple University. His essay is entitled, We Cannot Treat Negroes as Prisoners of War, Racial Atrocities and Reprisals in the Civil War. And it was printed in the Civil War History Journal. It's a detailed look at how the United States colored troops were treated by the Confederacy. One of the reasons why prisoner of war exchanges ceased was due to a Confederate policy of not recognizing members of the USCT as actual legitimate prisoners of war. This was done under General Orders No. 111, issued on December 24th of 1862 by Jefferson Davis. In it, it states that all African-American troops and arms were to be handed over to the states. They could be sold into slavery or they could be killed on the spot as insurrectionists. It also held that they could not stop being slaves because they did not have the permission of their owner. Therefore, they felt justified to, enforce these rules. However, Dr. Irwin's research is specifically looking at the events that occurred in Arkansas, being that he's actually from Arkansas. And so he looks at the USCT's pushback against the Confederate Army and how they eventually start retaliating themselves for the murders of their friends and loved ones. The last one is not your typical academic writing. As mentioned in the reading last week, amateur historians are becoming increasingly more popular. Such is the case with one Mr. Eric Wittenberg. Now, I actually know Mr. Wittenberg, and we've met on several occasions through the American Battlefield Trust, so I was already aware of his skill as a historian. His essay in the Civil War Times, which is a little magazine you can pick up at Walmart or Target or through the America History and Life database, you can find articles there, was entitled Lives on the Line. In it, he discusses the execution of Confederate captains William F. Corbin and T.G. McGraw by Union forces in May of 1863. He particularly focuses on how this action led Confederate commanders, including Colonel Robert Ould and General John H. Winder, to explore the possibility of executing Union prisoners of war at Libby Prison located in Richmond, Virginia, as an act of retaliation. Now, this is going to be key for me because in the Lieber Code, Dr. Francis Lieber is very specific that retaliation cannot occur. When the U.S. Congress attempts to pass retaliation laws, Lieber will actually reach out to Charles Sumner and request his assistance in trying to prevent that from happening. So understanding how the Confederate Army itself would come to the conclusion that, hey, we need to start retaliating ourselves for every one of our officers killed, and then understanding how Lieber's interpretation of the legality of retaliation is vital to understanding the entire package for his General Orders 100, aka the Lieber Code and prisoners of war. Thank you.